Hi, Dimitris.
Hello, Nand.
Very nice to have you here. Today, my guest is Dimitris Bertsimas. He's the Boeing Professor of OR, the Associate Dean of Business Analytics, and also the Faculty Director of the Master of Business Analytics at the Sloan School of Management at MIT. He's a member of the US National Academy of Engineering and an IMPORMS Fellow. Dimitris received the John von Neumann Theory Prize, the Frederick Lanchester and the IMPORMS President Awards, among many other research and teaching awards. Dimitris published more than 200 scientific papers, several textbooks, and supervised more than 80 doctoral theses. He's the co-founder of 10 analytics companies, as well as of the Analytics for a Better World movement. Dimitris, you're certainly one of the giants of our field. It's a great honor to have you here. Thank you so much. How are you?
It's a pleasure to be with you, Anand.
Great. You were the only child of a middle-class Greek family from Athens. How did you spend your early days back in Greece?
Well, not that different from other children of middle-class families. I grew up in a neighborhood, middle-class neighborhood in Athens. I went to public schools, in elementary school, and a very strong, I got a fellowship, and I got to a Athens College, arguably one of the strongest high schools in the country, where it opened my horizons to many other new opportunities. When I was a child, I was particularly busy on two hobbies, which are also my hobbies today. I was playing chess almost every day, and I was collecting stamps, which I also do almost every day today.
Wow, I'm a chess player too. Which one is your favorite player?
My favorite player? Multiple. You know, somebody who comes to mind is from the early years, Casablanca.
Mm-hmm. Capablanca, you mean, right?
Capablanca is a Cuban,
yes.
Cuban champion. In the modern times, Fischer was an explosive player.
Mm-hmm.
Also, some of the Russian players are very strong and so forth. But
right.
I had a fun time reading their accomplishments and also studying their games.
Yeah, I'm very interested about chess too. Of course, my favorite player is Anand, right? It's my namesake. unfortunately, we don't have many Brazilian players other than Mequinho. He was a very famous guy, but he became ill. But yeah, so did you like any soccer, for example? Did you support Panathinaikos or
yes,
Olympiakos?
Yeah, I like to watch many sports. I mean, I watch in the United States. I watch almost every professional sport. I particularly like track and fields. You know, to this day, I remember all the world records on all these things. I like sports a lot. I've never been a particularly good in these things, but I enjoy. Sort of looking at watching the games and so forth. I mean, I'm reasonably knowledgeable in these things.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of sports too, particularly soccer, Formula One, and especially the Olympic Games. I get really addicted.
Brazil, makes sense.
Yeah, of course. That's why I ask you about the Greek teams, you know, the Olympiakos and Panathinaikos. Brazilian players play there, and I was curious to know. Any references, role models, heroes when growing up?
In the period? You know, I always admire scientists. From the time I remembered, my role models are people who sort of make their mark in their lives through science. And after I became a scientist myself, some of my heroes are people like Dick Karp, Laci Lovas, from more modern times, still alive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, generalist people that combine what I think deep understanding, but also from a human level, you know, people of character.
Yeah, they care about the world.
They care about the world, and uh-huh. They care about young people, which is also my values as well.
Yeah. When I think of Greece, I can't help but to think about the Greek philosophers. Did any of them attract your attention?
Well, when I was early classes when I was 12, 13, 14, all throughout high school, we were taught Aristoteles, Aristotle, Socrates, from in ancient Greek. Mm-hmm. So because, you know, we were teaching. So yeah, I found them to be quite, not that I understood every single word that they were teaching, but I found many of their ideas quite inspiring and useful, yeah.
Yeah. Your mother was a teacher and your father an engineer. Did that have any influence in your choice of pursuing a major in electrical engineering?
Not particularly. My parents did not want to influence me too much about what to choose. I mean, I was a good student in high school, and there's a national exam. So typically people that perform well in the sciences at the time went to the electrical engineering and computer science department in Athens, the National Technical University, which I did. But they were not, they left me a lot of flexibility, my parents. They did not, my mother, for example, wanted me to become a doctor, a medical doctor. Mm. And later in life, perhaps this influence, I mean, I work in healthcare in a very significant way these days, the last 20 years or so. Mm-hmm. Two of the companies I have been, I started are in this mm-hmm. area. So, but they left me a lot of flexibility. And despite that they have strong views, my parents were strong characters, they allowed me to choose my own path.
Yeah, that's great. You're really close to them, right?
I was close to them. Unfortunately, both of them passed away in 2009. My mm-hmm. father from cancer and my mother from diabetes complications. Yeah, I was an only child, so my father was my best friend. We were quite close. Yeah, but you know, many, especially from middle class. Families in Greece, I don't think I'm unusual in that respect.
But do you still maintain strong connections with Greece, both professionally and personally, despite the loss?
I do, of course, yeah. All my cousins are there. My wife's mother is in Greece. So every summer we go. Actually, this Christmas, we're also visiting because my wife's mother is becoming up there in years. Professionally, I have been involved in this decade. I was the president of the board of directors in the largest university in Greece, the University of Athens, where I made an attempt to try to improve things. I'm in a board of a significant foundation these days in Greece, Bogosakis Foundation. So I have connections. I do have some connections. I wouldn't say fully professional, mostly personal, a little bit professional.
Yeah, but still, it's great to hear that you still, you know, have connections with your roots, and that's very nice. I think you can inspire people in Greece for sure, based on your outstanding curriculum. Were you exposed to R during the undergrad?
Yeah. So when I was in electrical engineering, as you mentioned, and my favorite classes were math classes. So I was told that in the mechanical engineering department, there was an operation research optimization class that was considered by the students extremely difficult, but it was interesting mathematically. So I took it, and then I was exposed. It was linear optimization. Mm-hmm. We're doing, in essence, linear optimization, duality, network flows. And I loved it. I thought it was a field, I still believe it, that could apply to many, many areas. And then I took a second class in stochastic modeling. In fact, I did my undergraduate thesis. Thesis was obligatory in that university. Mm-hmm. In queuing theory. I had a very talented teacher at the time, professor, who introduced me. In fact, we wrote several papers together that, at least in the beginning, influenced my trajectory in this field.
Oh, all right. So you already had experience with queuing theory already in Greece. That explains.
That's right. At the time I wasn't thinking, is it relevant? Is it important? This was not in my vocabulary. I was asking my question: is it mathematically sophisticated? Is it interesting? Mm-hmm. Later in life, I started questioning other things, so I did not continue with queuing theory as a result. But it's definitely something I learned quite strongly. I remember, for example, reading one of my early heroes at the time was Felix Polacek. Polacek is arguably the deepest queuing theorist. In fact, received the von Neumann Award the second recipient. Danzig mm-hmm. was the first, mm-hmm. and Polichik was the second. And I used to know quite a bit of his complex analysis theory and so forth. So I was attracted on the mathematics, not on the application.
Uh-huh. Nice. But what made you decide to leave Greece?
The realization that, I mean, I wanted to become a scientist and a professor, and staying in Greece, doing a PhD there would not be compatible with these aspirations and dreams. So I applied in the US, where, you know, I was a very strong student, and I received a fellowship to come to MIT in the mathematics department, applied mathematics department, where I came in 1985, immediately after I finished my my undergraduate degree in Greece. But it was really the aspiration of becoming a scientist. Mm-hmm. And also I was determined early on to become a professor.
Ah, okay. But did you apply to multiple universities or only MIT?
I did. I applied to multiple. I mean, I had offers for many. In the end, it was a choice of two: statistics department at Stanford and applied mathematics department at MIT. And for reasons that are some personal, mostly personal, I decided to come to MIT. And I, of course, it was a decision that affected my life ever since, because I have never left from this institution.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you had a choice between the East Coast and the West Coast, and you went.
But, you know, things, unfortunately, only the factuals are known, the counterfactuals. What would have happened if I went? Who knows that?
Yeah.
But as you will see, you know, that as a theme, I mean, I loved statistics and probability at the time. And in recent years, in the last decade, I returned to this. In fact, recently wrote a book on the subject. And so, you know, the world over a course of a long career like mine, I mean, you have the opportunity to go back to some of your original loves and explore them further.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So you went to the US, and adaptation can be very tricky for many people. How was it in your case?
I mean, in the beginning, MIT is a high pressured environment in graduate schools. I mean, if you look at my classmates, they were fantastically talented people. But on the other hand, I mean, I dedicated myself for the first 2 years I was alone to taking a huge number of classes, because I actually decided to do a double PhD, not two theses, double majors in a way, one in operational research and one in applied mathematics, which meant that I have to take all the courses prerequisites for both, and I couldn't double count. So as a result, the first 2 years I've been, you know, I was taking, the first year I took, remember, 5 classes the first semester, 6 classes, the graduate level classes. Mm-hmm. Nearly crazy. I didn't know any better at the time. So so altogether, I might have taken, I don't remember the exact number, but of the order of 20.
Wow.
5 courses.
Wow.
Because there were 2 requirements. No, but as a result, I had a very strong math education, because I took serious math classes, serious computer science classes, serious OR classes. Mm-hmm. And I had broader exposure to the fields. So the first 2 years was difficult. Then my wife, Georgia, also arrived, and then we got married. And then the third year, which was my last year of my PhD, we lived in Providence, Rhode Island. This was Georgia's first year in the as a doctoral student in applied math from Brown. So I used to commute. So we lived 2 years I lived 2 years in Boston on my own, and 1 year with Georgia in Providence during my graduate studies.
Right. You did the master's dissertation during the process?
I did a thesis in queuing theory, mm-hmm. Continuing my undergraduate. I had an idea of how to, that's where the Polichik story comes into play. The so-called multi-server queue with general distributions at the time, still today, it's not a very tractable model. Mm-hmm. So based on what I knew, I proposed a model where the distributions are Coxian distributions. From Cox is a famous, still alive, probabilist and statistician in the UK. Mm-hmm. And I had some success on that, and that was my master's thesis. And then my PhD, I did something completely different. My advisor was Amedeo Doni, a fabulous person, with whom I worked on extending a priori optimization. It was called how to optimize combinatorial structures when you have probabilistic information. So you see the theme that probability are always flirted.
Very recurrent.
Yeah, it was flirted with that and continued afterwards. And after a point, I didn't. But you see the early influences.
Yeah, but was it all theoretical work?
At the time, it was mostly theoretical work. Definitely, the queuing theory was theoretical work. Mm-hmm. It became, my PhD was a bit more practical, mm-hmm. but there was not a real world application at the time. There was no data per se. We had runs and so forth, computational runs, but it was on data synthetically generated.
Mm-hmm. And with the advances of simulation and other computational tools to better model real life problems, how do you see this bridge between queuing theory and simulation?
Queuing theory, in my opinion, is a topic that was developed, starting from the type of Erlang in the 20s and continued during the 20th century. But probability, in my opinion, inherently is not computationally attractive. That is, Kolmogorov, who developed the theory in the 30s, was not looking for computation. He was looking for axiomatization and so forth. And the scientific community took queuing theory in its, I was in a way a victim of that, in trying to do computations, which is not designed to do. Probability theory and correspondingly queuing theory can do approximations, limit theorems, but exact computation or nearly exact is outside its scope. So as a result, I didn't recognize this when I was younger, but after I graduated, I start trying to apply, and then I said, wait a minute, this is not the right. That's one influence. The other influence, I would say, is that the 20th century was primarily a world of where we didn't have a lot of data. In the last couple of decades, we have the big data revolution. When you don't have a lot of data, I think it's appropriate to substitute for data with imagination and create probability models. Today, I see this need far less because we have so much data, you don't need to make up distributions. You can work directly on the data. So as a result, I see the need for stochastic modeling nowadays, not zero, but less. Because even in the big data world, there are still situations that don't have a lot of data, let's say COVID in the early ages, mm-hmm. in the early stages, where we did not know much. So I see a need, but I don't believe I see a fantastic need in a big data world where we have a lot of data to design. Mm-hmm. So as a result, I feel that the fields that only depend on probabilistic assumptions and so forth are, in my opinion, on the decline, not on the upwards move.
Right. Yeah, we'll get back to that later. You completed your PhD very fast. How many hours did you work per day?
I don't know. The first 2 years when I was taking courses, a lot. But when you complete your PhD, obviously there's an element of ability, but a little of also luck. Oh. That is, you have to have the right idea early on and so forth. I work hard. I work more harder in the first 2 years where I was taking courses, where I had many homeworks and stuff, but than later. So I work hard, but not unusually so.
Mm-hmm. So to summarize your period as a student, did you suffer from any lack of confidence at any stage?
Not really. I would say it's not also my character. From an early stage, my parents raised me with the idea that I can achieve everything in life. Whatever I put my mind, I can achieve. It's probably not true, but it's one thing is reality and the other is what you believe. And this was not something I formulated on my own. I formulated it instinctively given my parents' teaching. For example, when I was in university, the National Technical University, the duration is 5 years. Nobody has finished in 4 years. So I put myself to finish in 4 years and I succeeded. without compromising grades, so I was able to go to graduate school. But it's my nature to put high objectives, at least what I consider high objectives at the time. Maybe now they are not so high, but sure. But you know, at the time, and I attempt, and most of the time I succeed, not all the time, but I didn't have any confidence. I also have succeeded, so as a result, you start having doubts when you are some question marks, yeah, in mind. You know, luck plays a role in these things, Anand. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I understand perfectly. Yeah, we need luck anyway. It's very hard to rely completely on our efforts. It's a combination, ultimately.
Yeah, and that was the case with me, I would say.
Yeah, but after finishing your PhD, did you do any postdoc or did you join MIT straight away?
It was my third year, and there was an opening came to MIT, and an opening was at Cornell at the time. Mm-hmm. I only applied to two this school. I didn't go a global search because, you know, it was only my 2.5 years when I was in the market, so it wasn't exactly, you know. I said, if I make it, I make it. If not, I will stay for another year. And I also would like to combine with my wife Georgia, so that we'll be in the same place. Let's see, if I would go to Cornell, she has already been accepted at Cornell. If I were to accept the MIT, she had been already accepted at Boston. So we combined, and it's again a matter of luck. The opening was there, and they selected me at the time at MIT. And then I stayed ever since. So I finished my PhD on a Tuesday, and early September of 1988, and I taught my first class the next morning.
Wow!
Not successfully, but I did.
Yeah, and you published your first book, Introduction to Linear Optimization, when you're only about 35 years old. Perhaps that is rather unusual in our field, and I have the book here.
Yeah. The history of this book is actually an interesting one. When I took the class as a graduate student at MIT, to be honest, I did not like it. I thought it was not well taught. It was taught by rotating people without fundamental, you know. I mean, when I took it, the person wasn't fantastic, the delivery. So then I started teaching this class, and I wrote a set of notes, which the next year I refined them, and then the year I refined them again. And then I recognized that a fellow from electrical engineering, somebody who became a close friend of mine and still is, John Tsitsikis, a fellow Greek, mm-hmm. has also been writing a set of notes. And then at some point we decided, I read what the thing were nicely complementary, and then
let's merge.
We merged and we wrote a book that each one of us has written 90% of it. So it's not that, but it's okay. I mean, it was very enjoyable experience. We worked pretty hard, both of us, and it was purely a pedagogical exercise. I mean, we did not to the theory of the field. I mean, the theory of the field has been and still is quite well established, but I think the pedagogical contribution is helpful, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
The book has survived the test of time, has been used by maybe 40, 50 universities every year.
Yeah, we recommend this book to our students that are interested in doing higher studies in linear optimization. It's mandatory for them. And I think many people agree with me that this book is a masterpiece, especially the first 7 chapters. I like, for example, the way you present the duality theory. Some books, even classical references, present a dual problem out of nowhere, you know, and that always bothered me. And I use your way starting from the primal, relaxing the constraints, putting penalties until you get the dual. And what was your motivation in this case?
I mean, when I took the class, it was ad hocly presented. I said, this doesn't make any sense. You know, so I found a way to do it. So, I like writing books. It's one of my favorite areas, particularly to view topics somewhat differently than how it is. You know, these days I write books more of a research and, you know, new areas and so forth. But this book we didn't discover fundamentally new things. Maybe we discover things to present it better or more intuitively, but it was not. But it, you know, given my level at the time and given my understanding, I would say both of us, I would say, would agree that it was a success. And we're quite compatible with John.
And a geometric perspective also.
Geometric perspective is actually, actually both of us think geometrically. I mean, you know, I do proofs with pictures and then try to translate it to mathematics. That's how I think. I mean, that's my.
Yeah, it can be even, you know, more intuitive for certain people to understand and to follow. So trying to combine both the geometric and the math itself can be an interesting strategy, pedagogically speaking. And regarding your book, Machine Learning Under a Modern Optimization Lens, I'd like you to comment on two affirmations. The first one is machine learning is inherently linked to optimization, not probability theory. And the second one, the ultimate objective in the real world is prescription, not prediction.
I stand by both comments. So I would say, if you look at the history, I like to think of fields with a historical perspective. And the way statistics has developed, people think about probability and statistics. Namely, there is a data generation model that uses uncertainty that generates data. And then people think about properties. But that's not what is happening in the real world. This is what's happening in mathematical heads. What's happening in the real world, there is data. That's it. And then from this data, you can ask questions about, you build models, and then you, some of them parametric, some of them non-parametric, and then you ask questions how to find these parameters of these models that can characterize them. Invariantly, you use optimization for that. So the idea that there are data generation processes that is not correct. I mean, I don't believe this is how data is generating. Mm-hmm. Probabilities is in our heads. They are not reality. So as a result, and the book makes it abundantly clear, is that the natural way of doing things is you have data, you define models, and then use optimization to find either the parameters or in a non-parametric setting to find the appropriate rules. I don't think there is a rule for probability. In a world, in other words, that is a big data world, the right, in my opinion, the right combination is probability and optimization. In my opinion, it's a weakness to consider probability and statistics. It assumes things not in evidence, mm-hmm. namely data generation processes. You ask me about heroes. Somebody who from whom I have been very much influenced from this is Leo Breiman. Mm-hmm. Leo Breiman, who had the advantage of being, started after finishing his PhD at Berkeley, worked for 23 years, I think, as a consultant. So he had real world input, you know, became a professor much later in life at age around 50, had it correct that, you know, he was a mature person with experience. And he wrote a paper, a fantastic paper. I recommend it to the readers, especially the younger readers. It was in Statistical Science. The title escapes me exactly, but it was a tale of two stories. Mm-hmm. That the view of the, I mean, he was not an optimization person, but he criticized the probabilistic view of the world that that gives rise to theorems of maybe elegant, but not characterizing the real world. That's the first statement. The second statement about prescriptions. Think about that. The area of most of machine learning and statistics have been primarily focused on predictive things.
Yes, yes.
What the weather will be tomorrow? Is this person going to die? Is the drug going to work? But if you think about it, the only reason we are making predictions is to make decisions. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, suppose I predict the weather is fantastic tomorrow, we have probability. So?
You leave your umbrella at home.
That's right, but you have to have some reason for the prediction. So, in my view, prescriptions, which is really an optimization perspective, mm-hmm. is particularly relevant. And in that way, I take the opportunity to talk to you about analytics. What is analytics? Mm-hmm. So, on the one hand, it's a combination, in my opinion, of two fields: machine learning, which goes from data to models to predictions, mm-hmm. to optimization, which is models to decisions, prescriptions. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if you take the union of these two, from data to models to decisions that have some value in society, I would say that's analytics, the science of using data to build models for better decisions that add value.
Right.
And I would say this is pretty fundamental on what I believe and the educational initiatives I have taken in recent years.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot for clarifying. That's a small lecture here we had. but you have another textbook on robust and adaptive optimization coming out really soon. And what is the purpose of this book? Again, no, uncertainties, probabilities.
Again, uncertainties, probabilities are not the same.
Yeah.
So I started in the year 2000. I had an interesting experience that influenced started my interest in this, and it was really empirical. So in 1915, Panama invited the United States to build the Panama Canal, connecting the two oceans, the Atlantic and the Pacific Ocean, and with the idea that in the year 2000, from 1915 until 2000, the American government was going to do the control of the canal, and then the control would pass to the Panamanian government. In 1998, 2 years before the passing of the control, the U.S. government invited me to create an optimization model for the scheduling of the canal.
Wow. So
I developed this model. I mean, I was very proud of it forth. I went and presented. Uh-huh. And in the end of the presentation, it was a large presentation with hundreds of people in the audience. One of the people asked me, I said, Professor, what will happen in your schedule if the tugboats that push these large vessels to put in the right places, uh-huh, so that you go up and down from in the canal, mm-hmm, what will happen if something breaks? And so in essence, they were asking me, how robust is your solution? And my answer was, I haven't thought about that. we haven't considered it. Embarrassing as it is, we have not considered it. We have considered a completely deterministic perspective. So did they, by the way, but it was an appropriate question. So I was embarrassed. And then at the time, I was looking in the literature and trying to see how I'm going to make solutions that are more robust. And this is the time that two great colleagues, Arkady Nemirovsky and Ronnie Bental, were writing early papers on continuous robust optimization. So I started working in this area. I wrote several papers with students and so forth. And maybe for about 15, 20 years, from 2000 until these days, I have been busy in this field. I have been writing quite a few papers and many implementations. So at some point, I thought to write a book on the subject, and I have a great colleague and a good friend, Dick Den Hertog from the Netherlands, with whom we share a lot of common beliefs about the world, both theory and practice. And we combined again forces. And in fact, in November 15th, we are about to publish a 600 pages book on robust and adaptive optimization that I'm quite excited about. I've been working on and off on it for more than 15 years.
Wow.
And Dick combined. So it's not I've done other things during this period, but sure. I would say it has been a long way going. Mm-hmm. I'm quite happy to, in a way, books I view as, not that I completely abandoned, but I write a book and then I would try to move on to something else. Mm-hmm. So I would say robust. This is an area I love. I have a class that I've been teaching for many years, a successful doctoral class at MIT. Hopefully with the book it would improve and many other universities might use it. But it's something that I think is quite relevant. Again, optimization leading to the theme of the discussion so far, optimization scales in dimension. Probability does not scale. Mm-hmm. Rather, my view is that you use probability to define parameters using single dimensions. Probability in one dimension is calculatable. Mm-hmm. It's a multiple dimension that the problem is happening. So you use low dimensional probability to calculate parameters of an uncertainty set. And then you use robust optimization, to scale in high dimensions. So now robust and adaptive optimization, in my view, is a theory that scales in dimensions. It makes practical contributions. I have used it multiple times in the real world. Mm-hmm. Many of the companies I'm involved in consulting efforts. So I feel it combines, it tries to model uncertainty in a way, in a tractable way. I'm not saying it's the only way, but it's definitely a useful one.
Yeah.
And at least in my opinion. And that's what we focused the book on.
Yeah, great. Then you also mentioned about finishing a book and trying to move on. It reminds me also some musicians or artists. For example, a musician can finish an album and then try to explore other things later on. Perhaps you can draw some parallel in this case.
Yeah. I mean, in my view, writing a book, which I enjoy doing, gives you an opportunity to visit the field more globally, mm-hmm, and to influence it. if the book is good. So, you know, I write books, especially now that I'm older and I have white hair, I write books to with this objective, namely to influence what our students learn and how to influence the direction of the field in the way that I believe is right, is valid. And a book given people's experiences is, in my view, a good way of doing it.
Right. You had done a lot of research work on several of our topics. We already mentioned queuing theory, optimization, and so on. Can you pinpoint what you think are your main scientific contributions?
Well, it's asking a father about who is your favorite child. So, I definitely believe my work on robust optimization that was 20 years had some impact. A paper we wrote on with my former student Melvin Sin, The Price of Robustness, is the most cited paper in operation research from its inception. I would say my work on machine learning and the modern optimization lens, so while more recent, I would say we have some influence on, for example, it clarifies things that I think the statistical community has confused. People believe that Lasso is for regression is a sparsifier, and the truth of the matter is it is only a robustifier. I mean, that's a pretty significant confusion, I would say. Uh-huh. And it's really because of a deeper understanding of optimization that allows you to do that. Or, for example, the work we have done with my former student and co-author in the machine learning book under modern optimization lens, Jack Dunn, about optimal classification trees, improving on what Breiman has done. I think it will be influential in the years to come. My hope is that some of the work I'm doing in healthcare these days has already been applied in a variety of contexts. I'm quite happy about that. And my hope would be that it would be influential in the future. You know, to be honest, all the works I've done, especially now that I am more, you know, when I was younger, I was in a sense, I was more influenced of, in a way, try to impress my seniors that I belong. To be honest, at the moment, what I'm trying to do is something that I think is relevant and important for the future. It's a very different perspective.
So to impress the younger ones now.
To be honest, I'm currently not trying to impress anybody. I'm trying to do things that, in my opinion, matter. I'm not always correct that they matter, but hopefully the frequency where I'm correct is higher than over time. So I gave you some robust optimization, the machine learning work, the healthcare work. You know, and I also like a good test of, you know, George Dancing, another hero of mine, said something that has influenced me every time I heard it. It said, the purpose of a theory is to solve the problems that motivated the theory. I repeat it because it's, you know, something we always often forget. The purpose of a theory is to solve the problems that motivated the theory. I mean, it's almost like a tatola. It doesn't, but we always forget it. So we forget it. So the way I actually implement this is that often I try to develop a company. If I believe something is valid, I try to develop a company that tries to apply it in the real world. And no good, I had some success on the matter. For example, in machine learning and remote optimization lens, we started a company called Interpretable AI with Jack and another student of mine, Jack Daisy. Daisy Zuo. So Jack and Daisy are my two partners for 3.5 years, in which we are applying what we developed in the real world. You know, so as an example, and many others. On I have applied robust optimization in multiple occasions in many of the companies I'm involved. So, hopefully, you have a sense of my.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks. We'll get soon back to the companies and your activity in this. Outside academia. So in your website, you share some of your personal stories, including the one involving the loss of very close relatives almost at once. You just mentioned that early. Still, you managed to take this experience and turn into something positive in terms of research. And that's what we're talking about healthcare and stuff like that. So can you comment a little bit on this, please?
Yeah, this was 2009. In 2009, I lost my closest three senior relatives, my father, my mother, and my only aunt, in the course of 5 months. To be honest, this was, if you lose, and I didn't have siblings, I don't have siblings, so it has been probably the toughest period of my life. Mm-hmm. I actually developed blood pressure during this period.
Oh.
Because you realize that, in other areas where I can do, perhaps I can do something about, in this case, death occurred and I couldn't help them. So I thought that I thought pretty hard when death faces you in the face, and I was 47 years old in that year. Mm-hmm. I thought, what to do next? Mm-hmm. What is the appropriate move? And I thought that I would dedicate many cycles of my day to try to help the health of people in a variety of settings, personalized medicine, new treatments, and so forth. And I think it gave some more meaning to my life. I have, at the time, I started some new companies in this space. I started working, producing PhD students at the time. So healthcare became a central part of my research life. It was really the key motivation was the loss of my family members.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You acted as a consultant for over 100 leading companies in the last 30 years. Can you name some of them, or at least their respective field of activity?
Yeah, broad. So the finance world, the insurance world, the mining world, the air transportation. That's the beauty of OR, actually.
Yeah.
And OR is, in my view, the best well-kept secret. It's an area that can really attack problems in every aspect of human activity. I mean, just look at my own, if you have the aspiration to do so that I do, I have worked in medicine, trying to build therapies for people that improves their outcomes, in healthcare operations to try to improve the efficiency of hospitals, in financial services to get better financial products better served to people. I've worked in air transportation more generally, routing of children for buses. I'm just telling you a few,
sure.
few things that
yeah,
I
yeah.
have done of my life. But the breadth of the field is, in my opinion, astounding.
Yes.
I mean, recently I've been doing some work in law, developing machine learning methods for organizing contracts in an automated way. I mean, computer vision. I mean, really, it's endless what the opportunity is. I mean, when I find, especially with the analytics paradigm, where you use data as a centerpiece, not models, mm-hmm. which unfortunately OR did in its early days, mm-hmm. I think the sky's the limit on what you can do. You can really work on a huge number of areas and making a contribution, not a small little thing. I mean, because people don't think, experts think, but not the actual people who you can bring a new perspective. So I find this very exciting to this day. I mean, I very much enjoy working on real world problems.
Yeah. Incidentally, I was discussing with Laura Albert a couple of months ago on how the society in general is not aware of OR. And she even mentioned that OR is a well-kept secret, just as you said. So what are your thoughts on this?
It's true.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we are responsible for it collectively. We are primarily, this is a collective comment, of course, has exceptions. I mean, not all of us are the same, but we don't publicize. Let me give you an example. I mean, arguably these days, the one of the leading methodologies of our times is deep learning,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
A Turing Award has been given. But let's think why deep learning has been so successful. Underlying deep learning is optimization.
Yeah.
Stochastic gradients. Nobody talks about this.
Yes.
I mean, as an example, I mean, where could I start? I mean, think about Nobel Prizes that have been given. I mean, the Markowitz Nobel Prize, it's an optimization model.
Mm-hmm. You're talking about the portfolio selection, right?
Portfolio selection, mm-hmm. there are many fields that, in a way, in the end, get a glory out of it. But if you look at the workforce, is really OR.
Yeah, the underlying OR, story is...
Yeah, and optimization, you know, but we don't do a fantastic job advertising. Better than in the past, but I would say more is needed.
Yeah.
You know, perhaps it's the science, it's the insular aspect of our character, mm-hmm. namely embarrassment when you say the accomplishments of the field.
Yeah.
But in my belief, this is a disadvantage.
That yeah, exactly.
I would like to present the topic. First of all, I believe in it. Mm-hmm. And I think we are making progress with the analytics revolution. For example, at MIT, we started this program, Master of Business Analytics. It's, in my opinion, one of my biggest educational contributions mm-hmm. in the field. We currently have about 2,000 applicants for 80 positions. 2,000 applicants. This is approaching MBA applications.
Yeah.
So, and I think the sky is the limit. So I think the key, in my opinion, even the name of operational research, unfortunately, is not fantastic.
Yes,
when I
yes,
say
yes.
People we do research in operational research is almost a joke. I mean, you know. Yeah. But now I talk about analytics. And analytics, especially if you enlarge the field to include data, I think it's a catchier story.
So maybe rebranding the field is an option?
That's my two cents on it, of course. You know, names, unfortunately, have a tendency to carry a particular weight.
Yeah, I have personal experience with that. I cannot convince anyone that easily to study linear programming, dynamic programming, queuing theory, you know, Markov chains. Maybe the names are not really fancy as artificial intelligence or machine learning, deep learning, reinforcement learning.
And the names of these fields have been developed in the 50s.
Yeah.
I mean, programming, for linear programming, in my opinion, is wrong. The right name is linear optimization. Programming means other things, computer programming.
Yeah, yeah.
So everybody, including my students, I get upset when I hear them. They talk about LP and MIP mm-hmm. as opposed to LO and MIO. So, but, you know, habits and we are intertwined with all these things. But it's fair to say that progress has been made. If you look at the field that when I started and the field that it is today with the analytics revolution, I would say the field is in a better place than before. And now, you know, many companies now know it. Mm-hmm. They might know OR, but they know optimization.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I would feel that it's the best period of the field in the 40 years I have been around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I hope I live to see a documentary by BBC, for example, on OR optimization, things like
that. We can influence this, Anand. By yeah. our work and its impact.
Yeah, yeah.
Our collective, I'm not saying my own or somebody yeah. else's, our collective impact.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. You co-founded almost 10 companies, which is really, really impressive. Could you share some of your experience regarding this matter?
Well, it was motivated by George Danzig's story. Mm-hmm. That is the ultimate objective of a theory is to solve the problems that motivate it. And the best way to test it, if you are in control of this. If you expect that others will take your theories and use it, I wish you luck. So I experimented with my first company, Dynamic Ideas, that was later sold to American Express for risk management and asset management. I've done a healthcare company where we use early on, this is maybe 20, about 20 years ago, building machine, we couldn't call it machine learning at the time, mm-hmm. machine learning models for insurance is another example.
Very profitable application.
Yeah, very profitable, but also useful, I would say. Mm-hmm. So I use companies as a way to, in a sense, experiment. It's one of my favorite activities, is to take a young company, give it some vision, and hopefully make it successful so that it can affect the world. In the process, perhaps wealth is generated, but that's not my objective. My objective is to make a positive impact to the world using things that I know something about. That's my objective. Mm-hmm. And while not everything I've done has been successful, I would say the majority has been positive.
So how many companies are there still? So
at the moment, I have 7 ongoing.
Wow.
Historically, I've sold 3 and 7 currently, you know. I don't run these companies. I don't want to, you know.
Sure.
I surround myself by very talented people. I'm typically a board member, sometimes the chairman of the board. And I make certain they succeed. I typically engage some of my former students or very close colleagues. You know, I view it's the idea and the people. It's a combined activity. And so far, I mean, I've managed to maintain good relations with all my partners over the years. It's a happiness producing exercise.
Yeah, I wish I had the opportunity, you know, to have this much applications and interactions with the real world, and you know, breathing the air a little bit outside the academia and put things in practice. And as you said, you need great people, and you try your best to be surrounded by excellent people around you, and that's very important, right? In your objectives.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
So let's change topics a little bit. What are the main challenges of being the editor-in-chief of a prestigious informs journal? Also, do you have any particular stories related to editorial decisions and so on?
I mean, I was involved in a committee. I were asked the committee of distinguished scholars and colleagues to consider an informed journal in optimization. It was my view at the time, and it's still my view today, that it should be closer to machine learning. Mm-hmm. The informs should be closer to the machine learning analytics revolution. The community decided that it wants more optimization than that, but they asked me to become the editor of chief, and I told them that my view is that we should have more analytics connections. So the journal now is the end of its third year. Mm-hmm. It has first of all been successful. It published about 25 papers a year in 4 sections.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It has attracted good publications. I'm not certain, you know, I'm not saying it's the best journal in the world, but it does attract. We have attracted high quality editorial board, some of the best scientists of our field, young and old.
Mm-hmm.
A biased perspective, but if you look at the names, I don't think you would disagree with that.
Uh-huh.
Overall, it was a smooth sailing. I did learn some things. I was more ambitious in terms of times. I was hoping to get the vast majority of papers, the first response in 3 months. 3 months we didn't succeed, but we succeeded in 4 months. I mean, you know,
not bad.
Fantastic.
Yeah,
it's not bad. The journal is in a good start. I would say when at some point I step down as the editor in chief, I think that my successor will see a good, respectable journal that, with more love and more effort, will become mm-hmm. one of the top journals of our field over time.
Mm-hmm.
That's my aspiration, anyway.
Mm. Right.
I was asked to put it in a trajectory of winning. I think, biased as it is, I think I have succeeded in that.
Yeah. Did you have any experience, you know, conflicting reviews, and you really had to step in?
I mean, I'm inherently, you know, I have a general belief that our community in general has sometimes is too negative with the reviews. In other words, people are more conservative. You know, it's easier to reject than accept.
Yeah, I agree.
So
yeah.
I actually sometimes overrule some of the, in the positive direction.
Okay.
But primarily because, especially with young people, I mean, if you encourage a young person, you know, this might not be their best paper, but you encourage them, people improve with time. And the field benefits. If, on the other hand, you disappoint a young person, and what would the field benefit from that? You know, what to say, that we reject more papers? I think society doesn't improve in this way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also not a believer on pre-specified percentages of acceptance and rejection. You know, some people believe that having very tough rejection, you know, 7% acceptance is a good thing. I think it's a negative thing. I think we should encourage people. We should find what good is in in things, not what is negative.
Yeah, I see.
Every paper can.
I see a similar behavior sometimes when a lecturer fails a lot of students, and that is sort of a measure that, okay, I'm doing a right job because I'm, you know, putting a filter or something like that. I don't know. It's something that some people may have the. I don't know if it's, as you said, might be more convenient to be more conservative and to.
It is easier.
Yeah.
It is easier because you say, you know, reject and it's not your problem anymore.
Yeah.
You say, accept under major revisions, it continues to be your problem.
Yeah.
But it's not only that. I think it's a multiplying philosophy. If you get negative reviews yourself, you apply tougher and tougher standards, and then at some point nothing is good enough.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think this is valid.
Yeah.
I would say this, what is valid is to encourage, and especially young people, to be in our profession and contribute, because these guys over time will improve and they will write the best papers of the future or the best ideas. And if we discourage them early on, we might lose them. That's not correct. It's not healthy for the field.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying we should accept nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not.
But sure.
If you want to make an error, it's better to make an error on the positive than on the negative.
Yeah. Very interesting view. I hope some people get inspired by that. You are currently supervising 27 PhD students, and you already completed the supervision of another 81. What is your strategy to handle so many students at once?
First of all, I love my students. This is by far the best part of the job. I devote easily 40 hours a week on student supervision. I meet with them half an hour to an hour every week individually, and because many of us work in, I always have a single project with any one of them, and I meet with them one-to-one. And I also have sometimes multiple students in one project in addition to their own. So if you look at the, I bet I have 40 hours a week of meetings with students. And so far, I have to admit, I still I'm close to, you know, my students comment that they don't have to repeat where they are. I have a student, for example, who tends to remind me where we are. And I told him one time I patiently waited, but the second time I said, there's no need for me to, you know, I do remember where we are and so forth. You know, I love what I do. I'm experienced, and I think, and I'm also reasonably curious, so would like to explore different things. So at this point in my life, as you realize, the incremental publication makes no difference in how I'm perceived, but it makes a big difference for them. And I believe from experience, I can guide them effectively.
Mm-hmm.
I still believe it. The question is, if it stops being true, whether I will be able to detect it myself. I hope I will be, but at the moment, I feel I'm a positive presence as people's mm-hmm. advisors. I'm
mm-hmm.
the proof of that is my students do very well. They are placed in top universities around the country. They find fantastic jobs in industry, and some of them become leaders of their field. I mean, if you look at some of the leadership, some of them are my former students. I'm quite proud of it. I have a sense of pride of that of that matter.
Yeah, you're emotionally connected, and that perhaps helps you remembering easily.
I am. Yeah. I, what I particularly like is the human connection primarily, and the scientific connection. Of course, their combination matters as well. You know, it's another source of happiness
mm-hmm.
in my life. It's something I always try to think about is what adds happiness to my life. And I would say young people surrounded by young people, and also in academia, in industry, in the companies I'm involved, is definitely a happiness producing exercise.
Yeah. My name Anand means happiness, so I hope this conversation contributes a little bit with that.
Thank you.
So Pedro Monari, a dear friend of mine, he's a professor here in Brazil, he asked me to ask you, how do you select your PhD students and postdocs?
To be honest, when I was younger and I didn't have as many resources, I was trying to find who is the best intellectually and so forth. I don't do this anymore. I think anybody from MIT, at least the students we have, are fantastic young people. I primarily, The only criterion I use is whether there's a human connection. Some people might be fantastically intelligent and so forth, but there's no human connection. First of all, they will understand. They will never ask me to be their advisor. So it is naturally, to be honest, the key aspect. There are some traits in people I like. For example, positivity. Hmm. So I believe that success in research and success in life generally is very much influenced by how positive you are. A negative attitude, I don't care how smart you are, doesn't lead, in my opinion, to success. Hmm. So if I detect negativity, I typically, you know,
step
withdraw.
Back. Yeah.
Step back. Good heart also. So trying to help others, not to prove you are the smartest person in the room, because at MIT you realize you have stuff to do. It's pretty high crowd. Yeah. So trying to help. And I, if you see, you know, many of my students are the first to volunteer on things and so forth. So and it's not that, to be honest, the students select me, I don't select them.
Oh, right.
So at the moment, you know, for the last 10, 20 years, I mean, when I was much younger, mm-hmm. It was a different story. But what happens today, one of the reasons, I also have more resources now. I mean, mm-hmm. I have grants and things, more credibility perhaps. So as a result, I have the resources to, you know, but it's an enjoyable activity. I mean, as I told you, happiness mm-hmm. producing.
Mm-hmm. How do you organize your time to cope with multiple complex activities in parallel?
Well, you know, experience matters in life. You become better. If somebody told me when I was beginning my career that I would have 27 students, I'll say, you are joking. I mean, somehow I managed. You know, I organized, you know, I remember where I am. I mean, I do remember my obligations, mm-hmm. and of which there's an increasing number. You know, at the moment I can handle. I mean, I do believe with age there's a turning point. I'm not certain. I don't think I am. I passed it, but at the moment I handle. So, you know, I mean, I write. I have a calendar, electronic calendar, where all my activities are written there. And every time I meet with somebody, I put the next meeting. I know what it is, and so forth. It has worked, not perfectly, but it has worked.
Right. Now, tell me more about the Analytics for a Better World movement. I know it involves the organization of webinars related to analytics and in the context of societal problems, right?
Yeah, this was a joint effort with my friend and colleague and co-author, Dick Den Hertog. Dick and I are positively reinforcing each other. So both of us care about applying our field for a world, you know, addressing poverty, the climate, the education, healthcare. So there are where, in a sense, because there are less money in this area, there have been, comparatively speaking, less activity as opposed to, let's say, retail pricing or financial services and so forth, that because the profitable activity, it attracts money and therefore attracts attention. So the hope would be that this will attract the best minds of our times. And over time, our field could contribute as a, in a way, an existential objective in that direction. So, you know, as you know, I don't know if you know that, but there's a book written by Cathy O'Neill, Weapons of Math Destruction.
Wow.
Talking about the negative aspects, you know. Uh-huh. I believe in positivity, as I think I became apparent in our conversation. Mm-hmm. And it is my strong belief that our field can be a significant weapon for the positive. Of course, as all aspects in life, you can move them. Nuclear energy can be fantastically positive or fantastically negative. It can kill the whole world. Mm-hmm. It's how you use it. And the same thing is in my opinion, for analytics. The analytics correctly done, mm-hmm. with the right aspiration, the right objectives, it can affect the world positively. It could, in my opinion, bring some of the major diseases to an end. It could decrease poverty in the world, hunger in the world. It could affect the climate and so forth. So, you know, especially as I become older and a little bit less, you know, trying to think where all of this means and what it leads. I, especially for young people, I have seen it with my eyes. I taught a class, Dick Den Hertog and I taught a class last semester at MIT. And we had about 25 students. First time it is being taught, also online because of the COVID. Boy, it had an effect on half of the students. Half of the students changed their lives because of that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, in my opinion, you know, an impressive thing to see. Yeah. I mean, it's not like I'm saying it publicly, but you know, it gives me a satisfaction that young people who I care about can be influenced in this way.
Yeah, yeah, that's a very interesting and fantastic initiative, and I really hope it affects people and it moves them to contribute and to do better for the world using analytics, right?
That's my hope. Yeah, that's our hope anyway. Yeah.
Yeah. You have been involved with initiatives that make use of analytics to help the fight against COVID-19. Can you give more detail about that?
Yeah, one of the, so many, but one particular one that I have some satisfaction about is together with my group, we developed a predictive model for COVID-19. It was part of the CDC initial model of four, still part of the CDC model, but most importantly, Johnson & Johnson used it to prioritize where to do clinical trials. For example, the fact that Johnson & Johnson, we started in May of 2020, and Johnson & Johnson, I remind you, did the trials in late September, October, and we made predictions at the time, what would be the places of high incidence at that time, 3-4 months later. And it has been quite successful in that respect. In fact, we selected to go to South Africa. That's why Johnson & Johnson had an early version of the variant, the South African variant. We went to Brazil.
Wow.
And the variant, the Brazilian variant, was where Johnson & Johnson had its trials. Mm-hmm. We went to Colombia, we went to Peru, places, in other words, that other people did not. And it's really because of these models. This particular model also is used today, actually, is used for sizing the beds for COVID among multiple hospitals. In fact, I had a discussion with the president of a hospital today, and he was commenting about the models and how accurate they have been and so forth. So, not that I intend to spend the rest of my life in these things. I mean, I'm not an epidemiologist, nor do I aspire to become. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I developed some knowledge together with my group. And my hope would be that our work will continue to be relevant and useful. For example, the vaccine distribution that the U.S. government decided has been influenced by some of the optimization models we have developed. So, you know, and it's really an amazing story of the young people in the group. I mean, you know, I have the advantage of having a very large group in which the vast majority of the people all contributed in this effort, Anand. Uh-huh. I mean, it was amazing to see, actually, wow. how much. And if you ask them, many of them who have since graduated, ask them what was the key aspect of your education at MIT, they comment that this collective effort to help the world has been a high point of their lives.
Yeah, it should have been a wonderful, and it should be a wonderful experience for them to take part of this very major project, and that can literally save lives.
We think so. I mean, I had fun doing it.
Yeah,
I'll do it again.
Right, you know, having fun and save lives, I think it's the perfect combination. What else you can ask, right?
Definitely, I believe it, yes.
Yeah. You have worked with many people in your career. You mentioned a lot of them. Who are the most important collaborators in your opinion?
Again, you are asking me difficult questions. most of my collaborators have been my students.
Right.
At the time, of course, later they have been. I very much enjoy working with Dick Den Hertog, for example. Mm. Similar seniority, if you like. Mm-hmm. Our views are similar. You know, clearly we have differences, but I very much enjoy working with Dick. I very much enjoyed working with all my book collaborators. These are people that I have developed close friendships, John Tsitsiklis, mm-hmm. Robert Weismantel. And in recent years, I have been writing books with some of my students, Jack Dunn, with whom we're quite close, we're partners in the company, mm-hmm. Alison O'Hare, was a student of mine, Polly Blank. I mean, I enjoy with working with people. I mean, I don't have a global order. I mean, you know, with a 99%, I have excellent relations with my collaborators. Uh-huh. 100%, we are imperfect, but the vast majority I have right. happiness producing again.
If you have to write a future work section from this conversation, what will you include?
Future, yeah. I think what became apparent, that, you know, I have thought about increasingly what is important in life. I have tried to give you sprinkles of these beliefs. But positivity matters. That another belief that I have is research can change the world if mm-hmm. you put your mind into that. Mm-hmm. And this is something I try to inspire my students to do, to basically have high aspirations and try to make a difference in the world. Even if they succeed, at least they tried and the mm-hmm. effort. And often people succeed, because especially capable, determined people succeed in life. Mm-hmm. The fact that you know, I was trying to learn. I mean, on a daily basis, I meet with my group members and so forth, and I learn. It's not, you know, the knowledge doesn't go one way. I mean, of course, I help the young people in some ways, but in a sense, because I work with many people, I learn many, many new things that I did not know. And this aspect of growth makes me feel younger as a result.
Right.
You know, 59 years old, and you know, I have no thoughts of retirement. I have no thoughts of I on a daily basis, the vast majority of my meetings are with young people, so we don't talk about these things.
It makes sense.
Yeah. So I, you know, and I think about happiness often. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to do things that increase happiness. Mm-hmm. Not glory, mind mm-hmm. you. Mm-hmm. No, not money. Not, you know, but some of them are positive with this, but I primarily try to think happiness.
Yeah. So you put that above prizes, awards, and
That. This come naturally or not naturally. I mean, obviously, it gives you a sense of accomplishment, but it's not that important if you think about it. Mm-hmm. You know, key for me is that I feel I'm contributing. I feel happy with my. I don't have regrets. Mm-hmm. I would say that's a significant story of my life. At least what I think at the moment. Of course, the life is not over. I mean, there are. Hopefully there are some chapters to be read, written.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's why I asked you what exactly the next chapters of your story. I mean, you spoke a lot about inspiring young people. The project of this, the subject to podcast or series of interviews, if you will, is to inspire young people. And I'm not that young, but I have been very much inspired by this conversation. And I'm absolutely confident that other people will be inspired as well. You know, I am from the informatics center, which is located in a place which is not in the main campus of my university, and it's in a place called Mangabeira, and we affectionately call this place Mangabeira Institute of Technology, as of course a reference to MIT. So when I said to some of my students, look, I'm going to talk to a professor from MIT, and they got confused for a while, but then they realized it's the actual MIT. And when I mentioned that to some of them really familiar with your book, which is, as I said, we make them read, they got really, really, you know, happy and impressed. And I'm sure they all be very much inspired for, you know, all your attention, kindness, and time for doing this. So this probably today has been one of the highlights of my career, and I'm very grateful, Dimitris, for being here and to, you know, take the time to inspire all of us. Thank you very much.
It's my pleasure to participate, and wish you personally the best, and your people who would listen, future listeners, I wish them luck, and I wish them also to make their own mark in the world. Hopefully some of them I will be inspired reversely.
Yeah. So I hope to visit MIT one of these days.
Of course, you are welcome here, and you let me know.
Yeah. Thank you so much once again. I'm really grateful. All the best. Ciao.
Bye-bye. Bye.